Hi everyone, my name is Akin and I would like to wish you all Happy Black History Month. Truly Alive Youth and Family Foundation has organized a month-long celebration themed Cherish Yesterday, Defend Today, and Protect Tomorrow. And as part of this initiative, we would like to present to you a youth-led short documentary film titled Black Trailblazers. In this film, we will be highlighting the life stories and achievements of Black heroes and role models who have paved the way for Black people here in North America. We will be highlighting popular figures such as Martin Luther King Jr., who many of you might know very well, and some others you might not have heard of, such as Carter G. Woodson. We would also be sharing the life stories of Black Canadian role models such as Jean Augustine. So sit back, relax, and enjoy this presentation. Allow me to introduce you to our first Black Trailblazer. His name, Carter G. Woodson. Carter G. Woodson was born in New Canton, Virginia on December 19, 1875 to former slave parents. Young Woodson worked as a teacher and school administrator after completing his education, where he eventually served as the Dean of College of Arts and Sciences. Convinced that the role of his own people in American history and the history of other cultures was being ignored and largely misrepresented among scholars, Woodson realized the need for research into the neglected past of African Americans. He helped in the founding of the Association for Study of Negro Life and History in 1915. He studied many aspects of African American history, including the first survey of free black slaves owners in the United States in 1830. In 1916, Woodson began publication of the Scholarly Journal of Negro History. It has never missed an issue ever since. Despite the Great Depression, loss of funding and support from foundations, and even two world wars. In 2002, it was renamed the Journal of African American History and continues to be published by the Association for the Study of African American Life and History. In 1926, Woodson pioneered the celebration of Negro History Week, designated for the second week in February, to coincide with the marking of birthdays of Abraham Lincoln and Frederick Douglass. It was later expanded to include an entire month, beginning on February 1st, 1970. And since 1976, every US president has designated February as Black History Month. And this is all thanks to the trailblazing work of Carter G. Woodson. If you take a moment to reflect on our theme once again, which is Cherish Yesterday, Defend Today, and Protect Tomorrow, you will realize that it all starts with our yesterday, our history. And that is what Carter G. Woodson has taught us with his life example. That history is not just an affair of the historians, but we all must and should take personal responsibility to acquire more knowledge and understanding of our own history. Because it's only when we cherish our yesterday that we can defend our today and protect our tomorrow. Just as he said, and I quote, "Those who have no record of what their forebears have accomplished lose the inspiration which comes from teaching biography and history."
Jean Augustine. The Honorable Jean Augustine is a phenomenal woman who dedicated her life to addressing systemic barriers and racial inequalities in the Canadian educational system. Born and raised in St. George's, Grenada, Jean Augustine immigrated to Canada in 1960 at the age of 22 as a qualified teacher. One can relate to her experience of working odd domestic jobs to pave her way through furthering her education. During her trailblazing years as a federal member of parliament, the Honorable Jean Augustine broke the glass ceiling multiple times as the first black woman who served as the parliamentary secretary to the Prime Minister of Canada in 1993. While serving three terms as the chair of the National Liberals Women's Caucus, she was appointed Secretary of State for Multiculturalism and the Status of Women in 1994. She continued to gain ground as the first black Canadian to occupy a deputy speaker's chair in the Canadian House of Commons for Foreign Affairs and International Trade in 2002. We owe thanks to Honorable Jean Augustine for championing the unanimous vote to pass the historic motion making February as Black History Month in Canada in 1995. Amongst her notable achievements was the legislation to protect disadvantaged low-income individuals, specifically mothers, securing legislative support to erect the famous Five Monument, the only statue featuring women on the Parliament Hill. And today, her humanitarian works continue internationally. In 2007, Jean Augustine was nominated by the Government of Ontario to become the first Fairness Commissioner, a position created to advocate for Canadians with foreign professional credentials. She said, "Black history is not just for Black people. Black history is Canadian history." Jean Augustine's story is a testament to the power of hard work and devotion in pursuit of social justice.
Martin Luther King Jr. was born on January 15, 1929 in Atlanta, Georgia. King was an American Baptist minister and the leading activist in the civil rights movement. King's activism started when he was the spokesperson for the 1955 Montgomery Bus boycott when he was only 26 years of age. King is best known for advancing civil rights and leading marches for the Black right to vote, desegregation, labor rights, and other civil rights through nonviolence and civil disobedience. King helped organize the 1963 March on Washington, where he delivered his famous "I Have a Dream" speech on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial. On October 14, 1964, King won the Nobel Peace Prize for combating racial inequality through nonviolent resistance. In his final years, he expanded his focus to include opposition towards poverty, capitalism, and the Vietnam War. In 1968, King was planning a national occupation of Washington, D.C. to be called the Poor People's Campaign, where he was assassinated. Martin Luther King Jr. Day was established as a holiday in cities and states throughout the United States beginning in 1971. My favorite quote of his was, "Our lives begin to end the day we begin to keep silent about the things that matter." Speaking up against anti-Black racism was not popular in the 50s and 60s. Majority of Americans, including Black people and their clergymen, criticized him for his activism. He got stoned, spat at, even stabbed. But he never stopped because he was standing up and speaking up for what was right. We should all learn to do the same.
Harriet Tubman was born in Dorchester County, Maryland in March 1822. In 1849, Tubman escaped from slavery to Philadelphia, only to return to Maryland to rescue her family soon after. She brought relatives with her out of state and guided dozens of other enslaved people to freedom. Traveling by night and in extreme secrecy, Tubman, or Moses as she was called, never lost a passenger. She made her rescue missions using the network of anti-slavery activists and safe houses known as the Underground Railroad. After the Fugitive Slave Act of 1850 was passed, she helped guide fugitives further north into British North America, Canada, and she helped newly freed enslaved people to find work. When the Civil War began, Tubman worked for the Union Army first as a cook and nurse and then as an armed scout and spy. She was the first woman to lead an armed exhibition in the war. She guided the raid at the Cumbury Ferry, which liberated more than 700 enslaved people. She was one of the earliest activists in the women's suffrage movement until illness overtook her. And she had to be admitted to a home for elderly African Americans that she had helped to establish years earlier. After her death in March 10, 1913, she became an icon of courage and freedom. Harriet Tubman is a symbol for bravery and the resistance of oppression. She changed the world by encouraging African Americans to fight for their rights and equality. She said, "There was one of the two things I had a right to, liberty or death. If I could not have one, I would have the other." Now, in 2021, under the Biden administration, the Treasury Department resumed the effort to add Tubman's portrait to the front of the $20 bill and has hoped to expedite the process. Harriet was a powerful Black woman and pace setter for many more female Black leaders to come. Harriet gained freedom for herself, but never forgot others who were still in bondage. And she would go on to risk her life and freedom several times over to freedom. Although we don't have much record of her words and speeches, her whole life was and forever will be a perfect example of selflessness in practice and not words.
Our next trailblazer is Ahmed Hussein. Ahmed Hussein was born on June 3, 1976 in Mogadishu, Somalia, where he learned to speak English from a cousin. He and his family fled to Nairobi, Kenya after the Somali Civil War intensified. Hussein practiced law in Toronto before his political career started in the fall of 2001 at the age of 25. He started as a volunteer in the Legislative Assembly of Ontario, then got hired as an assistant to the leader of the province's official opposition. From this point, he worked his way up and rose up the political ranks in Canada. He founded the Regent's Park Community Council, the representative body that facilitated a $500 million Canadian dollar redevelopment project in Regent's Park in Toronto. This was one of the largest of such initiatives in the country. In December 2014, Hussein presented himself as a candidate for the Liberal Party of Canada seat in the riding of York Southwestern for the 42nd Canadian federal election. The victory made him the first Somali Canadian elected to the House of Commons. On January 10, 2017, Hussein was appointed Minister of Immigration in Prime Minister Trudeau's cabinet, also making him the first Somali Canadian to serve in the government cabinet. He currently serves as Minister of Families, Children and Social Development, as well as the national president of the Canadian Somali Congress. Over the years, he has received many awards, honors, and recognition for his public work. Like many of us, Ahmed Hussein was an immigrant in Canada and has been able to achieve so much success and influence that now puts him at the helm of affairs of the nation. Such success and accomplishments are possible to all immigrants and racial minorities in Canada. Like he said, and I quote, "Canada's strength is in its diversity. That is why the government of Canada is investing and working with organizations that directly serve Canada's Black communities to ensure every Canadian has an equal chance to succeed, no matter the color of their skin."
Mary Ann Shad Carey was born on October 9, 1823. She was an American-Canadian anti-slavery activist, journalist, publisher, teacher, and a lawyer. She was very accomplished. In 1848, Frederick Douglass asked readers in his newspaper, The North Star, to offer their suggestions on what could be done to improve African Americans' lives. Mary Ann, only 25 years old at the time, expressed her frustration to him in a letter saying, "We should do more and talk less." Douglass published her letter in his paper. While in Windsor, Mary Ann founded a racially integrated school where she offered daytime classes for children and youth and evening classes for adults. In 1853, Mary Ann Shad founded an anti-slavery paper called The Provincial Freeman and served as its editor, making her the first Black woman publisher in North America. It was published weekly and lasted for 4 years before financial challenges forced the paper to close. Shad Carey's former residence in the U.S. was declared a National Historic Landmark in 1976, and in 1987, she was designated a Women's History Month honoree by the National Women's History Project. In 1998, Shad Carey was placed in the National Women's Hall of Fame. In Canada, She was designated a person of national historic significance with a plaque from the National Historic Sites and Monuments Board. My favorite quote from her is, "It's better to wear out than to rust out." And Mary Ann was a very outspoken activist. In fact, she was the most active activist one could ever imagine. And she committed herself to education, educating herself and others in her community. Mary Ann had taught us to take time to acquire knowledge. Knowledge about ourselves, our history, about the issues we advocate for, because knowledge will always be the most powerful tool for progress and upliftment of a people.
I am the greatest.
Muhammad Ali. Muhammad Ali was born on the 17th of January, 1942 in Louisville, Kentucky. He was an American professional boxer, activist, entertainer, and a philanthropist. He began training as an amateur boxer at the age of 12. And by the age of 18, he won a gold medal in the light heavyweight division at the 1960 Summer Olympics and turned professional later that year. Ali was the leading heavyweight boxer of the 20th century and has been ranked the greatest heavyweight boxer of all time. Outside the ring, Ali's success in music earned him 2 Grammy nominations. He's also considered the father of rap and hip-hop music. In 1966, Ali refused to be drafted into the military, citing his religious belief and ethical opposition to the Vietnam War, explaining, "Why should they ask me to put on a uniform and go 10,000 miles from home and drop bombs and bullets on brown people in Vietnam? While so-called Negroes in Louisville are treated like dogs and denied simple human rights." Ali's activism and objection of the Vietnam War made him an icon for the counterculture generation, as well as racial pride for African Americans during the Civil Rights Movement and throughout his career. Ali was once recruited by President Jimmy Carter, US President at the time, on a diplomatic mission to Africa to convince African leaders to join the US-led boycott of Moscow Olympics. January 19, 1981. In Los Angeles, Ali talked a suicidal man down from jumping off a 9th floor of a building. He was also known for his philanthropy. He helped about 22 million hungry people around the world. He was also a huge advocate and donor towards education of young black people. Ali's life and example showed us that black people could excel tremendously in their careers and still stand for what is right and stand with the community. That is, it is never enough to just attain personal success and excellence, but we should use our success and attainment as platforms to challenge the status quo and commit to the betterment of our communities and humanity at large. My favorite quote from him is, "Service to others is rent you pay for your room here on earth."
The success of every woman should be the inspiration to another. We should raise each other up, make sure you're very courageous, be strong, be extremely kind, and above all, be humble. The inspiring words of American professional tennis player and former number one in women's singles, Serena Janika Williams. Born on September 26th of 1981, Serena Williams is famous for revolutionizing women's tennis with her powerful style of play. Williams has won 23 Grand Slam single titles, as well as the Lowry Sportswoman of the Year Award in 2003, 2010, 2016, and 2018. With a passion for contributing to social change, Serena Williams not only advocated for gender equality in sports, she also demanded more recognition of women's contribution to the game of tennis, as well as equal pay for all genders in tennis. As her career has progressed, Williams has become more involved in social change, expressing her views on her social media platforms. She has received several awards for her activism and was listed among the 35 most remarkable and beautiful Black women in the world by Essence Magazine. The National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, also known as the NAACP, honored Williams with the President's Award of their annual NAACP Image Awards. Williams continues to give back to her community, and in 2004 and 2005, Serena and her sister Venus visited hospitals and played several tennis matches in predominantly black cities to raise money for the local Ronald McDonald House charities. As part of the Serena Williams Foundation's work, Williams helped to fund the construction of the Serena Williams Secondary School in Matuni, Kenya. The foundation also provides university scholarships for underprivileged students in the United States. She has been an international goodwill ambassador for the UNICEF since 2011 and has helped launch UNICEF Schools for Asia campaigns. Serena Williams is a role model. And while we might not necessarily need models in our lives all the time, it's always great to have someone who, by the way they live their lives, also inspire us. Serena is that person. Someone who is driven to work hard to win, and someone who knows that being vulnerable is a mark of strength and not weakness.
Donovan Bailey. Born December 16, 1967, is a retired Jamaican-Canadian sprinter. He immigrated to Canada at age 12 and played basketball with John Dagenhart. He began competing as a 100-meter sprinter part-time in 1991, but he did not take up the sport seriously until 1994. At the time, he was also a stockbroker. He was coached by American Dan Favre. Donovan Bailey once held the world record for the 100 meters. He recorded a time of 9.84 seconds to win the gold medal at the 1996 Olympics, making him the first Canadian to legally break the 10-second barrier in 100 meters. He was particularly noted for his top speed. Bailey ran 12.10 meters per second, the fastest ever recorded by a human at the time. He was inducted into the Canadian Sports Hall of Fame in 2004 as an individual athlete and in 2008 as part of a relay team. In 2005, he was also inducted into the Ontario Sports Hall of Fame. After racing, Bailey started his own company called DBX Sport Management, which helps amateur athletes find a way to promote themselves. He also started a sport injury clinic in Oakville, Ontario. In August 2008, Bailey began work as a track commentator for CBC Television at the 2008 Summer Olympics. He returned as the track analyst for CBC's coverage of the 2016 Summer Olympics. In 2016, he was made a member of the Order of Ontario. In 2017, Canada's Walk of Fame honored him with a star. As an athlete, Donovan showed how hard work and determination can result in outstanding success. Our favorite quote from him was, "You have to beat the king to be the king. No one is going to hand you a gold medal."
Our next trailblazer is Elijah McCoy. Elijah was born free on May 2, 1844, in Colchester, Ontario, Canada, to a family of fugitive slaves who had escaped from Kentucky to Canada via helpers through the Underground Railroad. After schooling, Elijah McCoy moved into Michigan. Although he had great qualifications as a mechanical engineer, due to racism, he could only find work as a fireman and oiler at the Michigan Central Railroad. Whilst working there, at the age of 28, he invented an automatic lubricator for oiling the steam engines of locomotives and ships, patenting it in 1872 as improvement in lubricators for steam engines. McCoy continued to refine his devices and design new ones. 50 of his patents dealt with lubricating systems. Booker T. Washington, in The Story of the Negro, 1909, recognized him as having produced more patents than any other black inventor up to that time. This creativity gave McCoy an honored status in the black community that had persisted to this day. He continued to invent until late in his life, obtaining as many as 57 patents, most related to lubrication, but others also including a folding ironing board, and a lawn sprinkler. Due to insufficient funds to manufacture his inventions, lubricators with the McCoy name were not manufactured until 1920, near the end of his career, when he formed the Elijah McCoy Manufacturing Company to produce them. He is credited in some biographical sketches with revolutionizing the railroad or machine industries with his devices. Although Elijah faced a lot of racial discriminations in his life that made schooling and working difficult for him, he never gave up. Rather, he always found a way to turn those stumbling blocks into stepping stones and turn those lemons into lemonade. And that's why we are celebrating him today.
Gladys West. Gladys May West was born on 27th October 1930 in Sutherland, Virginia, in Dinwiddie County, a rural county south of Richmond, to a family of sharecroppers. She grew up to be a renowned mathematician. From the mid-1970s through the 1980s, West programmed an IBM computer to deliver increasingly precise calculations to model the shape of the Earth. West's data ultimately became the basis for the Global Positioning System, GPS. West was inducted into the United States Air Force Hall of Fame in 2018, one of the highest honors bestowed by Air Force Space Command, AFSPC. The AFSPC press release at the time called her one of the so-called hidden figures, part of the team who did computing for the US military in the era before electronic systems. A reference to the 2016 book by Margot Lee Shetterly, which was adapted into the film Hidden Figures. As Gladys West started her career as a mathematician at Dahlgren in 1956, she likely had no idea that her work would impact the world for decades to come. West agreed, saying that she had no idea at the time that her work would affect so many. When you're working every day, you're not thinking, what impact is this going to have on the world? You're thinking, I've got to get this right. As an alumna of Virginia State University, Dr. Gladys West was nominated and won the Female Alumna of the Year at the Historically Black Colleges and Universities Awards in 2018. Dr. Gladys West has shown us that we don't always have to necessarily set out to change the world or anything like that, but rather just focusing on the responsibilities and tasks right in front of us and doing it diligently. And that could lead to world-changing results, though we might not see it at the moment. It is interesting to note that, till today, Dr. West prefers using a paper map over a tracking system, saying she still trusts her brain above all.
Our next trailblazer is Amanda Gorman. Amanda is an American poet and activist, born in Los Angeles, California, on March 7th, 1998. She was raised by her single mother, Joanne Wicks, a sixth grade English teacher in Watts, with her two siblings. Gorman attended New Roads, a private school in Santa Monica, for grades K to 12. As a senior, she received a Milken Family Foundation college scholarship. She studied sociology at Harvard College, graduating cum laude in 2020 as a member of Phi Beta Kappa. While at Harvard, Gorman became the first person ever to be named National Youth Poet Laureate in April 2017. She published her book, The One for Whom Food is Not Enough, in 2015, and later became the first author to be featured on XQ Institute's Book of the Month in 2017. In 2016, Gorman founded a nonprofit organization called One Pen, One Page, a youth writing and leadership program. In 2019, Gorman was chosen for one of the Root magazine's Young Futurist, an annual list of 25 best and brightest young African Americans. In 2021, she delivered her poem, The Hill We Climb, at the inauguration of the US President Joe Biden, becoming the youngest poet ever to read at a US presidential inauguration. Her poem indeed represented a moment of unity in her country. Her inauguration poem generated international acclaim, stimulated her two books to reach best-selling status, and earned her a professional management contract. My favorite quote by her is, "For while we have our eyes on the future, history has its eyes on us." Amanda has inspired many young Black girls like me. Amanda has shown that as a youth, she can climb her own personal hill en route to newfound fame, remarkably, as a poet and a performer, always rooting for fairness and rightness. Can we dig deep and climb our own individual hills by confronting whatever adversities stand in our way and strive to achieve greatness?
Merci d'être resté jusqu'à la fin de ce film documentaire. Vous pouvez maintenant constater par vous-même l'immense contribution des Noirs à notre monde actuel. De plus, en tant que Noir qui regarde ce film, il est important de noter que quoi que vous ayez fait face aujourd'hui, notre ancêtre ont traversé des difficultés similaires, voire pire, et quand même réussi à les surmonter. Donc, vous pouvez faire de même. Et pour mes camarades noirs, vous avez peut-être remarqué dans la vidéo que de nombreux noirs ont commencé leur voyage héroïque dans leur jeunesse. Cela devrait vous dire qu'on n'a jamais trop jeune pour commencer quelque chose de grand. À Truly Alive Youth and Family Foundation, nous croyons fermement que les jeunes ne sont pas seulement les leaders de demain, mais aujourd'hui. Pour en savoir plus sur la fondation Truly Alive Youth and Family Foundation, sur ce que nous faisons, ainsi de façon dont vous pouvez bénéficier de nos programmes et services, cliquez sur le lien juste là. Merci.